You can upgrade a modular computer anytime you want. Any of the parts in it, on either side of the interfaces, processor card, you can upgrade that whenever you want. You can share it between any devices that are compatible. And if anything breaks, rather than throw away the whole computer, you can just replace or get repaired the broken part. When you're done with the part, on any bit of the computer, you can sell it, you can give it away, whatever you want. At the moment, all products that you can buy, your tablets, laptops, they're hermetically sealed units. Some of them don't even have the ability to put in memory cards. So if anything breaks, that's it. You've got two stark choices. One, well, get it repaired, but that can be often so expensive that you might as well not bother, or two, throw it away. That's completely unacceptable these days. There's perfectly good components in those devices which could be carried on, we could carry on using if they were modular. You could actually replace just the bit that was broken. In 2007, I was contacted by a friend of mine who had just bought two beautiful and very unusual handheld computers for their children. They were very low cost, they were absolutely fantastic, except that they didn't do the things that the children wanted. They couldn't run any of the flash games that they were expecting to be able to do that they could do with their PC. So unfortunately, those low-cost computers were a complete failure for those children. If, however, they had been modular computers where you could replace the system, the actual processor and RAM and the storage, that mother of two children would have been able to say, "I'm sorry, kids, I made a mistake. Give me a month, maybe we'll speak to grandma, we'll get you an upgraded processor card." Because of this policy of designing computers as one part, it's not possible to do. You have to throw the whole thing away. Well, in engineering, people already buy modular designs. They're told computer on module. The difference here is that these computers will be available in mass volume from supermarkets, but they will still be usable for engineering purposes. Now, to illustrate why that's important, to remain competitive, a friend of mine tried to use China low-cost tablets for his project. He was doing a wireless fridge dash kitchen monitoring application. And so he found some company selling $35 complete tablets, which he would be able to take the tape part, take the circuit board out of it and use that in his project. That was the idea. So when he got to a meter high stack of $35 tablets, he gave up. The reason why he had to give up is because whenever he contacted these people, they sent him samples, no problem. But then he said, "Okay, I need to replace the operating system on this this board. Can you help me with that?" And they would reply, "Yes, give us an order for 20,000 units and we'll supply you with the source code." Now, I do know of people who've actually done that, and foolishly, they gave them the money, got the orders, and the people in China then went, "Oh, I'm so sorry, we lied. We don't have the source code either." Which is not particularly good, but there's nothing you can do about it. So by contrast, all of the modules that we're supplying will have the software available for people to download so that they can replace it and upgrade it and do whatever they want. Yes, that's the plan. The plan is that you will be able to buy these computer cards off the shelf. One will be £25, the faster one would be 40, and the top of the line one would be £70. Then on the next shelf will be a desktop unit, a tablet, a video player, a media center, and a laptop, and a picture frame, an e-reader, all the kinds of things that you would expect to have that are computing appliances, but with the ease of being able to choose what mix and match what you want to get, and importantly be able to share the card between devices, saving you 30% of the cost of the device. So that's the plan. Well, here's the first prototype desktop unit that we've got, and here's a CPU card. Very robust. It's in a case, you can put it in your pocket. It's as easy as slotting it in there. That's done. You've now got a dual core system with 2 GB of memory. Later on, take it out, put in a replacement card. Simple as that. This, by the way, is capable of running Android. It's a low-cost card that will be available retail for probably about £20. And this one is capable of running office applications, internet browsing, even some basic games, playing videos at full screen, full HD videos, and that will probably retail for about £40 or something like that. So the later on we will have a little bit more available, some products available such as a tablet, a laptop. My favourite one that I really want to see is a digital SLR camera, where you will actually be able to put the really cool thing about this is you currently have your digital cameras and you take the memory card out. Instead, what you would do is you'd take the system card out. Right? Now, in this case, this one has micro HDMI, micro USB, micro SD. So you could actually leave it in the video camera or the digital camera and plug in a keyboard and a screen, and the editing software will be on the computer card. You don't have to take the memory card out and put it into a bigger system. You've actually got the software installed on the card itself, which is fantastic. Now that's the kind of thing that we can do. So as a general rule, you will have a system card for a particular purpose. So there will be a games card, and we have someone who is making a handheld games console. So his system card will have a stack of games on it, which you will be able to move to your tablet from the console to your laptop and whatever, and swap over. So when you want to do some work, you just push a button on the side of the laptop and put in the office card, office system card, and then when you want to relax the thing. So the nice thing about that is that you don't end up with games on your work computer. What about schools? Well, there's a really good bit about this as you think about it. If you've got a desktop unit which is in the classroom, at the moment you have to spend quite a lot of money on secure software, logins, you have to get Microsoft Office, you have to have network access, it's an administrative headache, and you have to have an IT specialist managing all of the systems. By contrast with this, you give each of the kids a computer card. They're responsible for it, they transfer it from unit to unit as they go from class to class, they can take it home and carry on working, and it's cost so little, although it's Wouldn't be nice if it got lost or stolen or broken. You wouldn't have to replace the entire computer, all right? Because the base units that they go into will be at the school. Now, there's an additional thing. I'm speaking to this guy who would like to get some of these because they've been donated. Companies keep donating computers to these schools when they're end of life. The problem is that these computers are so large, I mean, they're desktop units, they're so large that 20 computers delivering it to a school, he has to hire a truck. He has to get a truck with a trailer on the back in order to be able to deliver these things. By contrast, this is 40 grams. That's 3 1/2 by 3 1/4 by 3/4 of an inch. So it's, I worked out once that you can fit 40,000 of these into 1 cubic meter. So you can go, you can put them in the post to the schools, or you can, you know, go and deliver, you know, on a motorcycle, he'd go and deliver things and put the computers in a rucksack, you know, and deliver an entire batch of computers to a school. So there's a huge saving in using these lower cost computers. Yeah, it is. But what we've got is an artist impression, very kindly done by a friend, Christopher, which shows that it will be in a beautiful wooden case. So that's metal rails down the side, a metal front, and then wood on the top and the bottom. So yeah, you won't just get a circuit board, I promise.